Sup guys, welcome to today's show. So today I'm going to talk about my flagship project, RUNLOCK. It is by far the most ambitious program I have ever written. It's probably the most advanced, but I will explain everything to you step by step. So what is RUNLOCK? Well, imagine that you have a very important file. Let's say you're a security engineer and you have some source code that you need to run from a server, but you don't want anyone to steal it in case they hack your server. So what you do is you compile that code into a binary executable. And then you run my program against it. So my program can be run against any binary executable in Linux. So let me show you how it looks. So if you do RUNLOCK, it will take one source file and one destination file, which will be created. So let's say I try to run it against bin ls, and I want to create something called let's call it my ls, and then it asks for a password, and I will enter orange in this case, and then I need to confirm, and now it has created this my ls file. And if I run this one, it will ask me for a password. If I enter the wrong password, it will just do this. But if I enter the correct password, it will run the original file. The nifty thing about this is that it's virtually impossible to crack. So even if the most skilled hacker in the world, with all the computing power in the world combined, were to get a hold of this myls file, they most probably wouldn't be able to crack it and run the executable. And why is that? Well, doesn't just add some password protected step to this file. What it does is it takes the entire original file and it encrypts it using this password that you chose as the encryption key. Then it puts the entire binary in a block, a segment, when it creates this new file. And this new file patches my password protection code to the end of it. So when you run this code, my password protection code will be run. And if you enter the correct password, it will, in memory, it will not create any local files at all. But in memory, it will decrypt the original file byte by byte, and then it will execute that code block inside of memory. So everything is done inside of the memory and nothing is done on the hard disk drive. And the only way to crack this basically is figuring out the password. And if you have selected a long and hard password, then it will be virtually impossible to crack. All right, so how does this work? I will go into my code editor and I will tell a little bit about the different steps or how the binary is created. In order to understand a little bit about this, you need to know what ELF is. So ELF is basically .exe files in Linux. It has a specific format, which is an important part of this program, because if you're going to create one of these ELF files, you need to know how the actual file format works. And I'm not going to get too deep into this now, but the file begins with an ELF header. And inside of that header, it lists how many, let me do this, how many segments there are. And a segment is like a block of code or data or something which is grouped together with certain permissions. So how many segments? We will also have an entry point. An entry point is basically a memory address, because every part of the memory in the process is mapped to a memory address. And the memory address in this case is basically an offset from the beginning of the file. So an offset from beginning beginning of file of the file to where the first machine code instruction is. So there are a lot of bytes inside of this file, and this is telling me how many bytes from the start of the file should it begin executing the machine code instructions. And that's the most important parts of the ELF header, I think. But there's also all different kinds of stuff, like what kind of machine it should be run on and what kind of ELF binary. There can be statically linked and dynamically linked and so on. But these are the most important ones. After the ELF headers, there are one or several program headers. And a program headers is basically describing the segments. So if you have two segments of like code and data and stuff, then you will have two program headers. So the program headers describe where in the file they are located, the segment is located, so an offset from the start of the file, permissions for the segment, so basically read, write, execute. So read means the program can read that segment, and write means it can write to it, and execute means that it can execute code. So basically the code segment is executable. And there's also other stuff like memory addresses, because every segment will be mapped to a virtual memory address, and you can decide what range you're going to use and stuff like that. But the more important thing is, where is it located in the file and what permissions will it have? And how is my files organized? Well, we have two segments. The first is the encrypted original file. So in one big block, the entire contents of the original file is, and it's encrypted. And then we have, what shall we call it? The RUNLOCK segment, where basically the code for the RUNLOCK decryptor is located, but some other things as well. For example, if we want to be able to tell if the user specified the correct password or not, then we have to use some kind of a hash routine. Did you learn anything useful today? And you want to support this channel? Go to drbirch.com/support. You can also click the button Become a Member. Thank you for your support. Okay, so the RUNLOCK segment, it contains my code, which will decrypt and execute the original binary. So how is this RUNLOCK segment divided? It begins with a 16-bit number, and this is encrypted as well, using the same key as the big binary. And this 16-bit number describes the number of bytes the padding. So I'm gonna have a hash which will be checked against the password, but I don't want to put it in a static position because that would make it easier to hack or crack. So I will have a number which will be decrypted, and then it contains perhaps the number 30, and that means that 30 random bytes will follow. And it can be from, let's say, 10 to 65,535. And the actual block of the padding and the hash is always the max value, so it's not possible to check the size of the file. And if we have decided, or if it's randomized that 40 bytes is padded, for example, and this is 40 bytes, then we have the 256-bit hash right here. And it will be a SHA-hash. And then the rest of the padding will follow. That means that if you enter the wrong password, then this number will be decrypted into the wrong number. We will jump somewhere inside of this padding. We will not go directly to the correct position for the hash. And we will try to use this as a hash. And all of these bytes are totally random, spanning the whole range of different possibilities, which means it's totally impossible to see any difference between the actual padded bytes and the hash. So the hash will be compared against the password, and the result will be bad password. And if it's a correct password, then this number will be correctly decrypted, which means we'll jump to this correct hash and we will hash the password the same way and compare it to the hash which is stored inside of the file. And if those two matches, then we know that the key is correct and the process continues. And after this padded bytes, we have the actual code. And basically it's first data, then code. And this code is not very simple to write, because you cannot just make any C program and compile it into this, because that will be, that's not really a viable solution. So this part, this code, the decryption code, will needs to be written in pure assembly. And it needs to be written without any external dependencies. So that will be quite a lot of work. I will probably not have video episodes about it that like I usually do. I will probably just, when I'm finished with that part of the code, I will show it and describe it and talk about it. I will also make this part of the code public. The actual C code, there you will be following me along the way you're used to, and we will be coding it together. So, quite advanced project. I'm not sure if there exists such a tool. Probably there it does, underground somewhere. I haven't seen any public versions, but it's a very useful tool. It basically makes it possible to store binaries anywhere you want without having to worry too much about them being stolen. Yes, all right. So this first episode in this series is basically only about me describing this project. The next time we're going to code the C part, or the biggest part of the C code. It will probably take 2 episodes to finish. And as soon as I'm done with the assembly code, I've gotten quite far and I am making steady progress. Then I will make this public on my website or something. My repo, perhaps. All right, so that's basically it for today. If you like this series and if you are as excited about this tool as I am, please like and subscribe so you won't miss any additional episodes, and maybe also enable those messages, what are they called? Notifications, so you don't miss the next episode. And thanks for watching, and thanks for today.